Oh, Gwenpool. They can change your name to whatever they want, but you'll always be Gwen Stacy to me. Oh, hey there, interwebs. You're really getting in the habit of sneaking up on me. I'm glad you're here, though. I've got a whole episode based around physics and superheroes all cooked up for you right after the bump. Roll the bump. What's the matter with you? When I say roll the bump, you gotta roll the bump. Let's try it again. It's so hard to make a decent show for under a dollar today. The sources in this episode are in the description below, but the main source is this book, The Physics of Superheroes by James Author Bookington. Close enough. In today's show, we're going to look at the physics of Superman, The Flash, and Spider-Man, but I've got to warn you, the ending is sad. I promised myself I wouldn't cry. Just roll the footage. Superman, perhaps the most fascinating superhero in the DC comic book universe. I couldn't get through that with a straight face. We all know that's Batman, right? But Superman was created way back in 1938 by Jerry Siegel and Joe Shuster with a strong space drama science fiction fantasy undertone. Superman quickly caught the imagination of its readers. Kal-El, aka Superman, is shipped off to Earth by his parents from the faraway planet Krypton, which is about to explode. Baby Superman gets discovered on a family farm by an elderly Kansas couple, the Kents, who named him Clark. Thus was born Clark Kent, mild-mannered reporter for the Daily Planet. Throughout his childhood years, the Kents realized that there's something special about this kid. He's able to perform extraordinary feats like lifting up a car or outrunning a train or jumping extraordinarily high, and it doesn't take long before they conclude that Clark Kent might just be pretty super man. Thankfully, Clark's a nice guy with a loving family, and he does everything he can to keep them safe and protected, instead of melting them with his laser vision so that he can stay up past his bedtime. So about Superman's powers. Superman can leap tall buildings in a single bound. Later on, Supes would gain the power of flight and all the other powers ever, but we can discuss those later. Some of them are pretty crazy. Superman's super jump, however, is interesting, as it perhaps suggests that the gravity on Earth is far less than the gravity Kal-El would have had on Krypton. According to Superman number 1, it was said that Superman could jump as high as an eighth of a mile in a single leap. That would be just over 201 meters or 660 feet, which to put in perspective would be as high as a 30 or 40 story building, depending on the size of each floor. Now that is a serious jump. Let's try to figure out how much force Superman applies to the Earth while leaping a building using Newton's famous equation. Force is equal to mass times acceleration. First, mass. In the movie, Supes says that he weighs 225. The DC Comics Encyclopedia says 235, and the Physics of Superheroes estimates his weight at 220. Yo-yo diets are really unhealthy, Clark. For simplicity, let's go with 220 pounds or almost 100 kilograms. But wait, I can hear you saying, weight and mass are not the same thing. If Superman's on the moon, his weight, or the force of gravity acting on him, would change, but his mass, or the quantity of matter that makes up Superman, would not change. Get it? I said weight. Everyone's a critic. Generally speaking, when on Earth, the big blue Boy Scouts' mass and weight should be roughly the same. Just don't make that assumption when estimating the mass of an object or person that isn't on the surface of the Earth. Instead, multiply the person's volume by their density. But again, for simplicity, we're going to say that Superman's mass is 100 kilograms so that we don't have to figure out his density because there's only so much time in the video. Now, to get his acceleration, we'll need Supes' velocity. Velocity is often used as a synonym for speed, or how fast an object is moving. But in physics, velocity is a vector quantity that refers to the rate at which an object changes its position. What I mean by that is velocity is speed with a direction. The problem is that we don't know how long it takes Superman to leap the building. We may not know how long Superman's leap will last, but we do know that his final height is 660 feet. We also know that, or Google can tell us that, the acceleration due to gravity is 9.8 meters per second squared. So we can use this equation. It tells us that Soup's initial velocity must be 205 feet per second, or just over 62 meters per second. In the physics of superheroes, the author estimates that Superman spends 1/4 of a second on his leg muscles applying force to the ground before jumping. So if he spends 1/4 of a second pushing off on the ground, then his acceleration will be the change in speed of 200 feet per second, rounded from 205, divided by the time of 1/4 of a second, which comes to 800 feet per second squared, or about 243 meters per second squared. Corresponding force Superman exerts is 25,000 kilogram meters per second squared, or roughly 5,600 pounds. And now we have the peculiar case of Barry Allen. Struck by lightning in a lab filled with fancy chemicals gave him access to super speeds where he could outrun a bullet, run over water, and run up a building vertically? Does physics allow Flash to do all these fancy things? I doubt it, but let's see why. Flash was once able to run up the sides of a building because with his great speed, he's able to overcome the effects of gravity. Barry can run much faster than Superman, and he would ideally be able to reach the top of the building with additional velocity to spare. However, the question is not about the jump as much as it is about him running up the building. Now, to run, he needs traction. For traction, he'll need friction. According to Newton's third law, if Flash runs up the building vertically, he's going to need a component of the weight perpendicular to the surface along which he's running, which in this case is the face of the building, but it's not there now, is it? So there's no downward gravity acting on him normal to the face of the building, nor is there a reaction force directed outward. So technically, Flash can't do this trick by running fast. But when it comes to chasing sound waves, Flash does need to consider the Doppler effect, which in most cases he does not. Sound waves travel through air in the form of compressions and rarefactions, regions of alternating air densities. When Flash runs toward the sound, one region of compressed air or expanded air would reach his eardrums much sooner than how it would have if he were standing still. Thus, he hears a sound of a shorter wavelength or higher frequency because he's running towards the sound, so technically, he can't really outrun sound either. Not according to physics, at least. Now let's bite the bullet and discuss the concept of impulse with respect to Gwen Stacy's death. Gwen Stacy was knocked off the George Washington Bridge. Spider-Man unleashed his web to grab Stacy at the last possible moment, inches above the water, inches from death. But then to Spidey, and to my horror, by the time he pulls her up, she's dead. So what killed her? Was it the fall? Or the force supplied by Spider-Man's webbing? Let's find out. Once again, we can use velocity squared is equal to 2gh to calculate Stacy's velocity just before Spidey's web grabs her feet. Assuming that she falls from a height of 100 meters, her velocity is about 45 meters per second. The fall in itself couldn't have killed Gwen Stacy. It's fairly streamlined, it's not very far, but then the sudden jerk she receives as the web grabs her feet, that's the problem. To bring Stacy's 45 meter per second fall to a sudden stop, let's calculate the amount of force Spidey's webbing needs to provide. Now, force is equal to mass times acceleration, or force times time is equal to mass times change in velocity. Force times time, we call that impulse. This shows that to change the momentum of an object in motion, a force needs to be applied for a certain duration of time. If the time needed is large, then the force needed is less. However, in this case, Spidey doesn't have a lot of time to slow down Gwen's descent, despite his webbing being elastic. Assuming Spidey halts the fall in 0.5 or half a second, then the force applied by the web to break Stacy's fall, assuming Stacy weighs 50 kilograms, that's 4,500 newtons, which corresponds to about 450 kilograms, That's 9 times Gwen's own body mass. A force of 4,500 newton corresponds to a force equivalent of 9 g's in the 0.5 seconds Spider-Man takes to save Gwen Stacy, without sufficient time given for the extension of or the stretching of the web. The force is too large for Stacy's body to sustain and end up snapping her neck. Essentially, for poor Gwen Stacy, there wasn't much difference between being grabbed by the webbing or hitting the water. I gotta go! Comic book superheroes and physics have a long-standing association. Physics defines a set of rules that comic book heroes try to abide by, most of the time. No matter how powerful the superhero, these heroes still try to stick to the laws of physics. Sometimes. The laws could be as simple as Newton's laws of motion or as complex as Schrodinger's equations. These laws provide superheroes with extraordinary abilities to jump 200 meters high in a single plunge, catch speeding bullets, and receive stolen treasures. However, there are superheroes who tend to violate the laws of physics. Looking at you, Sue Storm. She's able to generate invisible force fields, and such a phenomenon really hasn't been observed within the constraints of physics. However, having said that, it is by no means impossible for physics to eventually come up with an explanation for these processes. All we need is time. It's only a matter of time before science fiction becomes less fiction and more science. You remember Marty McFly's hoverboard from Back to the Future? It's a real thing now. What do you mean it's fake? Magnets? Well, what's the biggest hoax you've ever fallen for? Let me know in the comments section below. So guys, this video kicks off Gwen Stacy Month. We're doing that in parallel with NerdSync's Webuary. If you're new here, then we'd love for you to subscribe so you can catch all the videos. And everyone, please like and share the video and check us out on Facebook and Twitter. Until next time, I'm your host, Jay Parks, and this has been That Sci-Fi Show.